Welcome. My name is Chris Wetterland, and I'm the Director of Education here at the Corning Museum of Glass. And it's my great pleasure to introduce tonight's lecturer, William Gudenrath. I'm going to call him Bill. Bill Gudenrath is a glassblower, scholar, and lecturer, and teacher. He is resident advisor for the studio and ensures excellence in the facility and in its programs. He is an authority on historical hot glassblowing glassworking techniques from ancient Egypt through the Renaissance and has presented lectures and demonstrations throughout the world. I myself have learned a tremendous amount from Bill since I've been here at Corning, which is not very long. I arrived in June. And while he definitely is an authority, I can also say that he is a supremely talented educator. He can patiently explain things in plain language that give us insight and understanding and appreciation, and so we are all the lucky benefactors of that tonight. Bill will preview an exhibition on Roman mold-blown glass that will open here in May by telling us about the techniques of Roman mold-blown glass, and one glassmaker in particular, a glassmaker named Ennion. Join me in welcoming Bill Gudenrath.
Thank you, Chris. It's great to be here, and I'm happy to be speaking about one of the things I'm most interested in, which is glassblowing. I started glassblowing when I was 11 years old, and I got really serious about it by the time I was about 13. And I've always been interested in glass history, so glassblowing's origins have always fascinated me, and I've worked on this question for years and years. So I'm going to show you tonight a little bit of what led to Ennion, the technological developments that made his work possible. And when I think of Ennion, first of all, I think of quality. Ennion's work, if you consider it in the context of the other mold-blown ware that was being made in the early first century AD, it's the best. It's way better than anybody else's. The sharpness of detail, the lack of chill marks, is still mysterious how he achieved that. And we'll talk a bunch more about that. But anyway, when I think of Ennion, I think of quality. He's the best. And I also think of three inventions that made his work possible. The first is glassblowing. He was among the first couple of generation of glassblowers on the Italian peninsula. And he was one of the first to blow glass into molds. But there's a third invention. I'm not going to tell you what it is now. But there's a third invention that is almost as important as those two. And it's so common that we tend to overlook it. It's right before our eyes here. In case you don't know the name Ennion, as Chris said, he was either a glass blower, he was the maker of the molds, perhaps. Maybe he was the entrepreneur who made all of that happen. We don't know. But on each of his objects, there is a rectangular box. You see it in the foreground, right in the center there. And it says in Greek letters something like, "Ennion made me, let the buyer remember him." It's a sales slogan. So the work of Ennion is right now on display at the Metropolitan Museum. And in May, that show will come here. And it'll be hugely augmented with other mold-blown vessels of that period. Should be a really good show. I want to put Ennion in context. In the context, I like to start with the biggest picture. And the biggest picture is that there are two kinds of glass on the planet. There is natural glass. This is a piece of obsidian you're looking at. And it's very old, obviously. It was formed in geologic ages ago. It is glass. It has all of the characteristics of glass. The planet has it all over it. Obsidian, it's a fine example of natural glass. There are other forms of natural glass. There's also man-made glass. Two categories, natural glass, man-made glass. This happens to be my favorite object in the museum, so I decided I would show it. It's just an example of man-made glass. It's called Anthem of Joy. You can see it up in the Contemporary Glass Sculpture Gallery. And it was designed by a Czech designer artist named Vera Lishtkova. It came to this museum in 1979. It was made in about 77. Came to this museum in a show called New Glass 79. And that's where I first saw it, and I fell madly in love with it. It's borosilicate glass, and that's a glass that was developed in the 20th century. It's the low expansion glass that makes objects of exceeding complexity like this possible. Other with soft glass would crack very easily. So there's natural glass, there's man-made glass. And of man-made glass, we have about 5,000 years of history, roughly. Maybe more like 4,500 years. Back in 88, 89, I worked on this book called 5,000 Years of Glass. And it's the book I was looking for when I was about 14 years old, 1965. It's a general history of glass, but in the back are 250 photographs of processes from casting and core forming all the way through to the most sophisticated processes of the Renaissance Venice. And this was a great thing to work on. But I never felt, and I don't think any of the other authors felt, that there were really 5,000 years of glass. It's probably more like 4,500 years. And the origins of man-made glass are lost in time. There's no way to completely accurately, with utter security, say how it began. Just like there are two kinds of glass, natural glass, man-made glass, there are two ways to shape a piece of glass. Cold working is certainly the oldest way. This is our cage cup. It's from the 4th century. It was probably made by a glassblower blowing a very thick-walled blank. And then it was passed on after it was cooled. It was passed on to lapidary workers, workers who were accustomed to carving hard stone to create decorative objects, beautiful functional objects and decorative objects. So what they did was the cold workers carved at this from the outside toward the inside, ultimately leaving a rather thin-walled cup. It's about 2.5 millimeters thick. And above the cup and around the cup is suspended, is supported, this decorative cage. It's supported with those little struts you see. If you blow on this hard enough, you can break it. These are phenomenally fragile. And the technology of cold working that was used here has, in my opinion, not been exceeded. This is 4th century. I don't think anybody's ever done anything more difficult or more complicated. This is a time when it was common for lapidary workers to take a piece of stone, this is called the tazza farnese, and carve through the stone to create decoration, not knowing exactly what was underneath the surface. This is a Corning Museum object. It looks like a celery dish. It's not in a primary case right now. It's in the study gallery. It looks like glass, but it's rock crystal. The great Czech sculptor Jerzy Harcibov, who for years taught at the studio, said to me one day that this probably took something like 6,000 hours to make. So the worker started with a chunk of stone, held it against rotating abrasive wheels, and gradually cut away rock crystal to do this, and ultimately polished it. And rock crystal is much harder than glass, so it would have taken a phenomenal amount of time. Anyway, glass can be worked just like stone, cold working, lapidary working. Of the hot processes, certainly the most basic is casting. This is our Astarte figure. She's a little figure about that tall. There are a lot of these in various museums sprinkled around. And I think she was made by glass workers ladling glass into an open-faced mold and then immediately pressing hard from above with a flat tool to push the glass to force it into the deepest recesses of the mold. And you can see there was a little bit too much glass, and around her feet, that's a bit of excess glass that we call flashing. Core forming is the earliest way of making glass vessels before blowing. This is Egyptian, it's about 1400 BC. I hadn't noticed before, but this has the accession number of 50.1.1, which means it was the first ancient piece of glass acquired by this museum. 50 means it was acquired in 1950. 0.1 means it's ancient. 0.1, again, means it's the first object. So this was bought by Tom Buechner in New York before the museum opened. This is another core-formed vessel. It's from about 1,400 years later. It's from the end of the first century BC, maybe the beginning of the first century AD. Exact same technique, 1400 years of this same rather slow, laborious process to make glass vessels. There was also fusing and slumping. People took slices of canes, fused them together to make a form a disc, wrapped an edge cane around, a decorative edge cane, and then slumped it over or into a form, probably a ceramic form. And they got it hot such that gravity over time would cause it to assume the shape of the form. That's called, we call that fusing and slumping. Flame working or lamp working is also incredibly ancient. It's an incredibly ancient hot working technique. Dates to possibly Egyptian times, but this is a Phoenician headbead, 500 BC, 400 BC, something like that. And for me, no question, the eyes were put on by flame working, and the eyebrows especially, it's especially evident there. The head, the hair was probably done by flame working as well. So we have flame working from that early. So what about glass blowing? Well, glass blowing begins right about halfway back. If you assume, like me, we have about 4,500 years of glass history behind us. Glass blowing's about halfway back. There's a simple timeline. And if you imagine a line at 4,500 BC, glass blowing's right about in the middle. And on the slide, I have earliest evidence of glass blowing. And the evidence is really specific. If I'd done this lecture in 1971, 72, I probably would have said glass blowing occurs someplace in the middle of the first century AD, maybe the early first century AD, because a lot of evidence has come to light in these last few decades. And here's the evidence to give the glass blowing, the earliest glass blowing, a date of 50 BC, maybe more like 40 BC, but something like that. The evidence is in the form of these blue tubes. And these are about 6 inches long. The tubing itself is not remarkable. There are many ways to make glass tubing without glass blowing. The remarkable thing is what you see at the end of them. They're broken, so that's why the photograph shows them in pieces. What you see is a bulge. And what a worker did, what someone did, is they took a piece of glass tubing, heated one end till it closed, and then blew in the other end. And that is the earliest closely datable blown glass. In this context were also found some simple vessels. So it wasn't just the blue tubes, there were some simple vessels with these also. So it's a very important date. They were found in 1972 in a mikveh, a ritual bath, in the Jewish section of Jerusalem. They were found by an archaeologist named Avigad, who made the Jerusalem Post in 1972. That's the article right there, glass blowing invented in the first century, a Jerusalem archaeologist shows. And this really did give us the earliest date for closely datable artifacts. I want to show you a rough reconstruction of the way I think this was carried out. There are a bunch of different ways to make glass tubing. This is just one of them. If you happen to go to the make your own glass department and make a glass flower, you actually do this. This is how we have visitors make glass flowers. But what's happening there, close to the end of that metal rod, is glass tubing is being formed. You see it being pulled off the reservoir, so to speak, at the end. The flower is irrelevant. That was just a way of freezing the edge. This tubing is about 6 or 7 millimeters in diameter. The wall is very even, makes very nice glass tubing. Now it's still hot, it's about 1,000 degrees. I reach down, chill the pincers, and tap while I squeeze the glass tubing with pincers. And the glass breaks incredibly cleanly and evenly. Look at the ends of the tubes when they come into view. Hot glass tubing below a diameter of about 10 millimeters breaks very cleanly. Now this is what they did after they made the glass tubing. They heated one end. This can be done in a stinger coming out of a furnace. It's kind of difficult to photograph it, so we reshot this using a Meeker burner. You can see what's going on a lot better. So if you look at the end of the tube, the glass is heating, and glass is doing what glass does. It becomes less viscous. surface tension causes the glass to try to assume less space and become spherical, the end begins to close up. And if you look carefully, you'll see the end completely close. This, by the way, is exactly how I started glass blowing when I was 11 years old. I got a chemistry set. Here's the blowing. So there's the bulge. And the radius between the tube and the bubble is even like the Jerusalem vines. Now, sometimes the tip doesn't close entirely. If you blow a little too soon and take it out of the flame a little too soon, there remains a teeny hole in the end, and one of the blue tubes has a teeny hole. So I want to show you how that happens. Anyway, for Christmas or my birthday, I got a chemistry set, and it had some glass tubing and an alcohol lamp, and this is what you were instructed to do. And I made one with a hole in it, just like this in 1962. The finds are datable about 50 to 40 BC. On to furnace glass blowing, the things we see at the hot glass show and the things that we see in the hot shops of the studio. There is a fundamental technological problem in furnace glass blowing. And that's what I'm showing you in these four photographs. There's the mass of glass, the bubble grows, and then the fourth slide to the right, you see the inflated glass, it's still hot. The question is, how do you get it off the blowpipe? If you look at this area right here, you see that the glass gradually thickens as it approaches this massive thick area we call the moil. It's a phenomenally strong structure. And if you simply let the glass cool to room temperature from here, the cracking, because of the difference between the coefficient of expansion of the metal and the glass, the cracking always invades the bubble and wrecks the bubble. So you've got to have a way to get the hot inflated glass off the blowpipe. So certainly the most important thing in furnace glass blowing was the realization that you can inflate glass, no question of that. But the second most was that you had to have some consistent means of getting the hot bubble off the blowpipe. This is what people do today. We use the two-bladed tool called the jacks to make a constriction between the bubble and the blowpipe. So you see the three or four stages of that. And on the far right, you see the neck or constriction, that is the weakest part of the structure. And if you do things right, it'll break easily and cleanly. But that's modern. I think that may even come from as late as the medieval period. People didn't do that in the ancient world. They did it differently. And we're going to see that again and again. And what I'm going to show you are some videos of my reconstructions of some early glassblowing processes. And it's a varied selection, so it'll be kind of interesting. They're to some degree based on this article. This was written by a scholar whom I never met. I spoke with him on the phone, David Gross. And in 1977, he published this excellent survey of what was then known about the evidence for early glassblowing. And it says the Western evidence. He also speaks of Eastern Mediterranean evidence as well. First thing I'm going to show you is the process for making what I call, I don't know who else might do that, but I call it the Engedi bottle. It's the thing on the left. It was found in a cave in the Judean desert, and it was found in 1960 by this archaeologist, Avigad. It's never been published. There's no photograph of it in any book. I visited Israel for the first time in 2008 to teach, and I said the one thing I want to do other than teach is I want to see the Engedi bottle. And I have a number of friends in the ancient glass world there, and they said, why? And I said, because it's cited in every book on early glass blowing, and I've never seen a picture of it. And I remember asking David Whitehouse, the top one is the Corning Museum of Glass, closest parallel, and in the catalog, he said, very similar to the Engedi bottle, and I'll never forget the day. I said, so what does the Engedi bottle look like? And he said, I don't know. I've never seen it. So I've seen the Engedi bottle. I've photographed it. There it is. Ours is a very close parallel. There's on the right one in Paris. On the bottom is from one from a museum in Croatia. Here's my reconstruction of the process. I do think it was made at the furnace with metal blowpipes, blowing glass offhand. For the glassblowers in the audience, you may be amused to know that there's no marvering here. When you gather glass well out of a furnace and blow the bubble gradually, you can have a phenomenally even-walled bubble. This is done with no marvering. The idea was to use as few tools as possible, of course. So what happens is the glass is inflated, and the jacks are used to divide it into two sections. One is the vessel body, you see that beginning to hang off the end, and the other is a tube between the vessel body and the blowpipe. This is holding it down in the furnace to get a little bit more elongating with gravity, a little more blowing to get it a little bigger, a little centripetal force to elongate it further. Here's the origin of those scars at the base of the neck, right at the shoulder of the vessel. There's a slight constriction made. That's optional. It can be done without that constriction. Then the bubble is heated just at the tip, and the bottom is flattened. It's then broken off the blowpipe and annealed. And I'm holding it with a clamp device that is commonly used by flame workers these days. The vessel can actually be cool. The opening is reheated in the stinger at the mouth of the furnace. The glass softens, and the final shaping can be done. This is what we call creating a rim or a furnace opening, creating a rim by holding the vessel at the bottom, reheating the opening, and tooling it. That's a furnace-finished rim. So it's the Engedi bottle process reconstruction. Another really interesting and controversial source of evidence for early glassblowing are Pompeian and other wall paintings. This one happens to be from a house called at Bosco Reale. It's in the Metropolitan Museum. You can see it. It's very close to the Ennion show that's up right now. And it's a painting that is said to date from the late 1st century BC. And there's some controversy about that, and there's been controversy about it for a long time, because a number of these wall paintings depict vessels for which we have no artifacts from that time. So this is showing, if this is 15-ish BC or 20-ish BC, it's showing a vessel we don't have examples of, closely datable to anything earlier than about 75 AD. And what we have here is a Corning Museum example that looks very similar. David dated this to 1st century AD. But it has the characteristic folded foot, it has the folded rim, and I'd like to show you my reconstruction of the process. Now you notice that the finished object doesn't have the tube up at the top. Here's another gather of glass, no marvering. This is a double gather, so it's quite a bit more glass than before. The bubble blows out very evenly, and I leave a thick spot on the bottom. This is going to have a punty. Some of these bowls have punties, some don't. They were held by a clamp. I'm going to use a punty on this, so it's essential to have a thick spot on the bottom for the punty to attach to. There's the initial bubble, and just like the Engedi bottle, I divide it into the vessel and the neck. This, I believe, is a fundamental part of the ancient glassblowing process. The bowl is about five or six inches in diameter, so it's blown up a little bigger. The neck is further elongated, and I make a slight constriction near the blowpipe. So there you have the vessel body, the tube, and the slight constriction. Next is the Roman foot. There was a phenomenal amount of creative energy put into glass blowing in the 1st century AD. One of the first things they came up with was the folded edge that we're going to see shortly. And this is the Roman foot. It's simply a constriction manipulated to form a very elegant base. To make the bowl, the bubble needs to be an oblate spheroid. It needs to be a little bit squatty, so that's what I just did. Now comes the time for the transfer to the punty. the punty or pontle, interchangeable, same thing. It's a metal rod with a little bit of hot glass on the end that's used as a temporary handle. And if you do it right, the vessel sticks long enough to complete the manufacturing process, and at the end, a sharp blow on the punty breaks it free and leaves the characteristic scar. Now the tube becomes an outer fold. Roman vessels almost always, maybe it's safe to say, have a folded edge. It's pretty, it adds strength because it's a double layer of glass. And now, with a series of reheats and toolings, the vessel is given its final shape. And there it is. This is flashed in the furnace. Oh, one more shaping. At this point, the punty is attached pretty lightly to the base, and just a tap frees it, and it's placed in the annealing oven. This is the next day, taking out a few examples that we taped. That's the one I made that you just saw. And you see a variety of shapes. They all have folded rims. They all have Roman feet. You see a great variety of shapes in wall painting vessels. Anyway, wall painting is a very important source of iconographic evidence of early glassblowing, even if they were from 25, even 50 AD, and there is thought that these wall paintings were touched up at a later date. They're still important sources for evidence of what vessels looked like in Pompeii, and you know, it has the famous close date of 79 AD. So it's a wonderful time capsule. Of course, Pompeii is in every respect, except for those who were there, I guess. Let's see. The next thing we're going to do. So we're going to look at something a little even more controversial. I believe that the Roman cameo vessels were made by glassblowing. Some disagree with that, and I would be delighted to be proven wrong based on close scrutiny of original objects compared with experimental results. That's my methodology. And on the bottom right of this is the Morgan cup that's upstairs. Was once owned by J.P. Morgan. It's the only one of these that's unbroken. When I've handled this, I've always done it over a tabletop with a piece of felt on it. I've never wanted to be the person to break that. They say I've handled the Portland vase. That's in the top left corner more than anybody in modern times. I don't know whether that's true because it was restored in the 1980s and they would have spent a lot of time with it. But I have had it in my hands, I can't count the number of times. It's the most famous piece of ancient glass in the world. And we believe that these were made in a workshop in or near Rome, something like as early possibly as 30-ish BC, maybe as late as 40 AD. So there was this workshop making cameo blanks for the lapidary workers who were in Rome, accustomed to carving hard stone, just like the Tazza Farnese that I showed you a few minutes ago. Carving glass would have been like carving balsa wood for somebody used to carving oak. Glass is much softer. So we have glass blowers, if I'm correct, we have glass blowers making blanks for lapidary workers. In the bottom left is a little scent bottle. It's teeny. It's about 4 inches in height. That's in the Getty Museum. And I've studied most of these very carefully. Never gotten my hands on the thing called the blue vase in Naples. Once David and I went to Naples specifically to handle this, and they wouldn't take it out, having said they would, but that's another story. So what you're going to see is a video of my reconstruction of the process of making the Getty scent bottle, this little one, which in every way to me bespeaks of glass blowing. It is an idiosyncratic process. These cameo vessels are covered with white only up so far. The glass, the white glass, doesn't ever go up to the top of the vessel. So what I've done is gathered blue glass on the end of a blowpipe. I blow a bubble and spin it to elongate it. The goal is to make a tube of blue glass. And off camera, I've made a slight constriction. Now, it's still hot. It's probably about 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. And I lower it, while turning it slowly, I lower it into a pot of molten opaque white glass. But you see, I don't cover the neck. So it leaves this area of bare blue glass up at the top. A little bit of marvering is used to control the temperature and prepare it for blowing. And there it is. The white glass re-softens the blue glass. The neck stays intact. The vessel body grows and is shaped, and it's broken free of the blowpipe. This little scent bottle, I'm convinced, was held with a punty. It was broken off the blowpipe. The end was reheated. Maybe it was held with a clamp. We don't have the evidence because that was all ground away. And the end was heated, and it was dilated slightly, given a slightly flared edge with a tool. And the evidence for that is that the bubbles in the glass that are elongated in the neck follow the profile of the curve. That wouldn't have happened had it been done with cold working. So that's yet another glass blowing process. The date is roughly 30-ish BC to 40-ish AD. And if I'm right that it's glass blowing, that's a very interesting process, carefully tailored to make a certain object for a certain customer, the customer being the lapidary workers, who then presumably sold them to the wealthy and powerful. Here's another important source of information on early glassblowing processes. These are called ribbon bottles. Sometimes they're called color band bottles. The two on the right are particularly beautiful. Those are in the Toledo Museum of Art. The others are from various collections. These are thought to be from the West. They're thought to have been made probably on the Italian peninsula, maybe in or near Rome. They're thought to be from the first half of the first century, so the period is right. The technique, to my eyes, is definitely glass blowing. And it's a very interesting process. They're made from bands of colored glass. So to make the bands, white glass is thinly covered with transparent colored glass. In this case, it's an amber glass. After reheating, this is flattened. The goal is to make ribbons, not round canes. Usually people pull canes and they're round. This goal is to pull a ribbon or a strip. One of the things that's particularly interesting about this particular group of objects is that the process that you're going to see over the next couple of minutes is a process of fusing, just as was done ages before glass blowing. But this is an example where fusing was combined with glass blowing. So there are the cross sections that reveal the white. I think they probably overlaid white glass with the colored transparent glass because they couldn't make the opaque colors. Here they are put on a piece of kiln shelf thickly covered with kiln wash, and that is to keep the glass from sticking to the kiln shelf. These are heated to the point that they fuse. And then they're picked up on the end of a metal rod. This is not a roll-up in the glass-blowing sense. It's a little deceptive there. The point is just to get the canes stuck on the end of the metal rod. They're compressed and then flattened to become a ribbon. This is elongated and folded. If you remember the bottoms of those two Toledo pieces I pointed out, you could see where the color bands wrapped underneath. So the fold is made, and with reheating and marvering and squeezing, this mass is made round. Here is a blowpipe in the foreground. That's a blowpipe. And I'm separating this mass of ribbons, this fused mass of ribbons, separating it from its gathering iron. And I'm going to cut it off and transfer it to the blowpipe. and of course it's crooked. Not to worry. With a lot of reheating and marvering and pushing the glass around, it's pushed back on center. And you can't see, off camera, is a blow hose. I like to use a rubber blow hose to blow so that I can marver and use the jacks and see the glass better. There's nothing historical about that, of course. So I'm marvering to keep the uppermost part of the bubble cool while I inflate the lower part. If I don't marver, the part near the blowpipe will blow out very thin and I'll lose the bubble. There's the inflated mass. Here again is this ancient glassblowing procedure whereby a bubble is divided into two parts, the vessel body and the tubular neck. I'm blowing, it's getting bigger there. And the last step is to blow it to its final size and to flatten the bottom. And just like the Engedi bottle, this is broken free of the blowpipe, annealed, and the last part of the work, there's the shot of the bottom. The last part of the work is done basically like flame working. It's held, the cooled vessel is held with a clamp, held at the mouth of a furnace or in a torch and some kind of a flame and shaped. I just created the folded edge. These bottles all have an inner folded edge. They have a slight flare. And if you look carefully at the last shot right here, you can see the inner fold. That's one of the characteristics of so much Roman glass. Tubular neck, bulbous vessel body. We see it again and again. Well, those are some free blowing processes. Those are all free blowing, no mold involved. It's just gravity, centripetal force, a couple of simple tools, strategy, timing, careful application of heat where it's needed, cooling by blowing on it, cooling by rubbing parts on a metal marver or a marble marver. That's free blowing. Ennion, of course, is known for mold blowing. It's incredibly fast, and I'm going to show you a clip made by two colleagues, two close friends and colleagues who live and work just west of London, about an hour west of London. Their names are David Hill and Mark Taylor. Mark Taylor is the glassblower. David Hill is a very skilled, talented person who can make the molds, and he makes molds better than anybody. In my book, these two know as much about Roman glass as anybody on the planet, and they're serious practitioners. They blow glass every day. They happen to be blowing Georgian glass right now. But for the 20 years or so that I've known them, they've mostly done Roman glass. And what I'm going to show you is an absurdly short video clip of mold blowing. Here it goes. It's 15 seconds long. There it is. Could we see that again? The glass drops into mold. The two parts are closed. There's a bottom part. There's a base. You'll see it when the two parts are removed. I'm counting seconds. That was 9 seconds. The whole process, the gathering the glass, maybe 10 seconds, 15 seconds, lowering the bubble, in another 5 or 10 seconds. The blowing is, it's an unbelievably fast process. The entire shape is created in this one blow. All the decoration is created in this one blow. A phenomenally important invention, mold blowing. And we'll look at it more in a few minutes. But arguably, this is the invention I said at the beginning that I wasn't going to tell you what it was. There's glass blowing, there's mold blowing, and there's cracking off. If you look at the rim of this Ennion cup that we looked at the beginning, if you look carefully at the rim, especially right here, you can see that the top of the rim is actually flat and that there's a chipped edge on the inside of the vessel and on the outside. This was not created by holding the thing at the bubble at the bottom, reheating the opening, and then shaping it. This was done by a process called cracking off. And it comes about this time, the early first century AD. So it's glass blowing, it's mold blowing, and it's certainly possible to finish a mold blown object and create a furnace finished rim. We'll see that in a few minutes. But what you see again and again with mold blown glass is a cracked off rim. You also see it with free blown glass. So here's the process. It too is absurdly quick and requires little skill. This is a blank I've made, and I'm making a scratch with a diamond tool. It's mounted on a turntable. This is a hand-powered turntable, a thing potters call a banding wheel. That's a little bit of clay that's used to stick it down. And I'm just centering it. There it is. Now, heat is applied. I use a torch here. You can use a thread of hot glass. Heat is applied. The glass expands at the surface. The scratch propagates a crack. And if you do it right, and you have positive thoughts, the crack goes right around and makes an instant rim. Look at that. You recycle the rim, of course. Now, the edge of that cup is so sharp that if you touch it, it'll cut you. So the moment you finish the crack off, you take a piece of sandpaper, or in this case, a little piece of sandstone, and gently rub the edge. And that makes it perfectly safe. It also creates all of those little chips you saw. And a cracked off rim is very subject to chipping. It's not anything like smooth such that it's resistant to chipping. A furnace finished edge is difficult to chip. A cracked off edge is very easy to chip. I mentioned this is associated with all sorts of mold blown forms. Here's a lotus beaker, another mold-blown object. These all have cracked-off rims. There's a chipped rim. You see that again and again with cracked-off rims. Now, this is that we have a beautiful amber Ennion ewer. This is one in the Eretz Museum in Tel Aviv. Or is it in Jerusalem? Tel Aviv, thank you. This is from the Eretz Museum, and I show this because the foot is original. If you look carefully at ours when it comes back from New York, from the show at the Met, ours has a restored foot. So if you want to see an original Ennion foot, this is a good place to look. It has a cracked off edge. The foot has a cracked off edge. The top has a furnace finished edge. In fact, it has an inner fold. You can see it right there. This is the characteristic flat, slightly chipped edge that is a cracked off edge. The process is associated with mold blowing. It's also associated with free blowing. These are first century free blown objects. They have these dents in them that are made by hand. That's not mold work. One of my favorites is this. This is a form called a Hofheim beaker. It's called a Hofheim beaker because one of the early examples that was closely datable was found in Hofheim, Germany. And this is a cup that's been beautifully decorated with enamels. It's in a museum in Locarno, Italy. And it is an example of Roman enameled glass. And enameling on glass vessels is an area of great interest to me. And so I've studied this type object very carefully. And the process is kind of interesting. If you look at the bottom left, you'll see the blank being decorated. And right where my left hand fingers are, you see the overblow. You see the uppermost part of the bubble. And that little hole was connected to the blowpipe. So I paint the enamels on, reheat the thing in a kiln, and reattach it to the blowpipe. And that's what you see on the right. You see the decorated blank reattached to the blowpipe. It's going in and out of the furnace. And it's fired in the furnace because these are very high fire enamels. To fire the enamels, you actually have to get the vessel soft. And the only way to do that safely is to have it reattached to the blowpipe or the punty. So if you look at the picture in the top, you'll see that it's cracked off. It's a little bit crooked. You can see on the left side, there's a glare on the edge. It's a very sharp edge. And if you look just below the edge, you'll see what's always described as a decorative groove. That was done by cold working. The vessel was mounted on a turntable, and a soft stone was held against it to create that rim. And you can see that it was done after the enamel was fired because it goes right through the enamel over on the left side. I think that's probably there so that if chips occur, that groove will stop them. At any rate, it's first century, free-blown, cracked-off edge. Sometimes things go wrong in cracking off. There it cracked. And if you look at the edge, you see it's crooked. Unevenness of the wall of the glass, maybe. Who knows what? It's uneven. And there's even the characteristic, you see this in a lot of cracked off edges, a little step. The crack goes around and doesn't come quite back to where it started. That's something you see again and again in cracked off edges. I mentioned before that a thread of hot glass can be used to heat the circumference where you want the form. Sometimes nothing happens. You do everything right again and again and nothing happens. And I was just about to give up on this one when that happened. I figured I'd put that in so if anybody's getting sleepy, maybe they'll wake them up. Well, cracking off is practiced all over the world all the time. It's just as common as glass blowing. It's just as common as mold blowing. It's everywhere. For example, this is a photograph from the 60s. That's a worker at the Swedish factory, Oreforge, the national glass company of Sweden. And if you look carefully, you'll see he's working at a table, two turntables. On the bottom of this arm is a diamond stylus, and he's making a scratch. And this is, of course, carefully held to be just the right height to make the final glass the right height. Over here at the same time, this is a torch, and it's heating the circumference of the one he just scratched. So this is the cracking off process. And any glass you buy at any Riedel glass you buy, any Baccarat glass you buy, and these can be easily $125 a stem, these are all blown into mold, and the rims are all formed by cracking off. You see it everywhere. If you go to the Pottery Barn and buy $1.50 wine glasses, the edges were formed by cracking off. It's an amazing invention, and it always amazes me that somebody came up with the idea that you could make a scratch in the glass, heat just this one area, and pop off the top. I think that's phenomenally inventive. Well, here's the Ennion ewer again, the Eretz Museum example. Again, with the cracked off foot and the furnace finished rim, I'm going to show you a video that is going to be running here at the museum during the show. It's a film that shows Mark Taylor, the Roman glassmaker. David Hill is not in this. Mark Taylor and a French fellow who's a very skilled Roman style glassblower, Francois Arnaud is his name, and they're making a replica of this. Now, David Hill carved the mold, and it's an extraordinarily beautiful mold. These are the two parts closed. On the left is the one for the vessel body, on the right is the one for the foot. Here they are open. You see that there are many parts to the mold. If you look at just the foot mold, you see there's the base mold and two side molds. Here, there are four parts. There's a base and three sides. The inside is thinly lined with soot, and that acts as a release material. It also protects the mold to some degree. These molds can be used 100, 150 times if they're well taken care of and not abused. So here comes the process. They're working at a wood-fired furnace, and this is in Germany. It was thought that it would be particularly relevant, particularly useful to see this at a wood-fired furnace. And so that's why you see it here. Everything at the wood-fired furnace, and I've worked at one many times, is just like working at a modern gas-fired furnace, except it's a little nicer. There's the bubble lowered into the vessel mold. See the three upper parts and the base part, there's the foot mold waiting. They pull up on the blowpipe a little bit, And there's the vessel. Now, meanwhile, Francois has gathered glass at another working hole. He's preparing the bubble, marvering it, blowing the bottom pretty thin. He reheats it, lowers it into the foot mold. If you watch his right foot, that's the universal sign for open the mold. There it goes. And there's the foot. Now, both of them reheat the tips of their respective parts, stick them together, incredibly on center, I have to say. That's phenomenally difficult to do. And they break off the blowpipe attached to the vessel. They reheat the end, and here comes the furnace-finished edge at the top. The rim has been folded in. You can see the double thickness there. It's kept hot while the handle is prepared. The handle is a flattened mass of glass with a little rib cut in it. We're gonna look at handles in just a minute more closely because they're very interesting. And the handle is finished. To my knowledge, this has never been done before. So there you have this confusing situation where you have a blowpipe used as a punty, effectively as a punty, used to, oh, I'm sorry, I'm pointing that out like you can see it. You have a blowpipe used effectively as a punty, used to reheat the opening and to shape the opening, to hold the vessel while the handle is put on. And at the very end of the process, after cooling, the excess glass is cracked off right there. And that's how you have the two together. It's broken free of the blowpipe that was used to make the foot and transferred to the annealing oven. And it's cooled to room temperature over a period of about 6 or 7 hours. This process of working is not without precedent. It's not without parallel. On the left is a Corning Museum example of a ewer, a pitcher. The handle's missing, obviously, but it too has a furnace-finished rim. It's not quite a folded edge. They, for some reason, gave up right at the last moment. It's almost a folded edge, and the bottom is a cracked-off edge. And on the right, from the treasure hoard found at Bagram in Afghanistan, is a very similar ewer. It too has a furnace-finished rim and a cracked-off foot. You see this technology again and again. Here it is. Here it is around 1900. This exquisite, beautiful collection of Joseph Hoffman-designed vessels for the Viennese firm Loebmeyer is up in the modern gallery. You can see it. This was going to be the cover of 5,000 years. That photograph, by the way, was going to be the cover of 5,000 years of glass, the book I showed you earlier, until about a month before it went to press. The 5,000 years was a joint, was a project that used a lot of Corning examples. And in the end, the publisher, British Museum Press, decided they wanted a British Museum object on the cover. Anyway, this wonderful photograph almost made it to the cover of the book. I almost had my way. At any rate, this is done the very same way as the Ennion ewer. Two teams of workers blowing each part separately, and then in the end, they heat the tips, join them together. In this instance, both edges are formed by cracking off, both the top and the bottom. But there you see it, essentially 2,000 years later. Well, 1,900 years later. These date from about 1900. So as I mentioned before, when I think of Ennion, I think of the absolute best mold-blown glass of the early first century AD. And I think of three inventions: glass blowing, mold blowing, and cracking off. They're almost on a par of importance. So this has all been kind of heavy, and I thought I'd give you a little bit of dessert at the end and do a little thing on handles. Handles are the one moment when the glassblower has a little bit of room for fantasy. And handles are tricky to make. In many ways, they're the hardest part of the process. And so I thought I'd give you a little tutorial on Roman handles. They're more interesting than you might suspect. These are examples of different kinds of handles. The one on the bottom right is a doubled handle. That's particularly neat. Rarely in Roman glass you see round handles, so that's what I'm going to start with. Here's the vessel. Here's a mass of glass that's been gathered and marbled slightly. It's sheared free of the gathering iron. Now, this is called a shear mark. That's a shear mark. And in virtually all, say, American glass, many cultures, many glassworking cultures, many European glassworking cultures, at this point, the shear mark is twisted and the second attachment point is made, and every effort is made to hide the shear mark. It can be done well or it can be done poorly, but if you look at a lot of pictures, you'll see shear marks. Here it is again. Here's the shear mark coming up. Here's the shear mark. Well, a few years ago, I was at David and Mark's studio near London, and I did a little demonstration of a piece for them, and it had a handle. And I did the shear mark like I've always done handles. And they said very quietly, you know, in Roman glass, there are never shear marks. And I said, sorry, what? They said, there are never shear marks in Roman glass. If you look at every piece of Roman glass you can get your hands on, you'll never see a shear mark. And of course, I went home and I looked at every Roman piece of glass I could get my hands on. There were no shear marks. Here's what happens. It's phenomenally clever. The second attachment point is made, and the excess glass is cast off, thus leaving what we call a cast-off thread. That's what you see right there. Now, it's going to get buried in the upper shoulder of the vessel, and it'll disappear. Again, that happens very quickly, so here it is again. Much trickier than it looks, I'll add. Much trickier. It's a little like riding a bicycle. You swear it's not possible until suddenly you can do it, and then you can't ever fail again, almost. Very tricky procedure. Most Roman handles are flattened, and I think that's entirely functional. I think that's because they lose heat more rapidly than a round handle.
Flattening.
There's a flattening process, and the handle is stuck on, and it's the same story. Cut off. Now, you may have noticed in the video of Mark Taylor doing the handle, he casts off a little bit differently, but it's the same effect. You saw the Ennion handle, so I'll skip that one. This is a phenomenally interesting one. This is a double handle. Just amazing. You see it in various kinds of Roman glass. The gather is flattened and then divided into two sections. No shear marks. There's the cast off. You can see the two threads disappearing. I'll show you that one more time from the front. You can see it a little bit better from the front. That, by the way, is a replica of our gladiator beaker. And there it is. So I can't wait to see the show. I think it's going to be great. I think it will be wonderful to have yet again a show of Roman glass in the museum. It's been since Glass at the Caesars, really, that we had a show exclusively about Roman glass. So I can't wait myself. I hope you join us to see it. Thank you very much. Thanks, Chris. Okay, thank you.
Does anybody have any questions? There's a microphone headed in your direction.
Hi, Bill. What's the molds were made from? The three and
David
two
Hill,
parts?
David Hill makes his molds from terracotta. They're unglazed earthenware. He has made, for production purposes, brass molds, and they produce objects that don't look remotely correct in that they leave a lot of chill marks that you'd never see in the Roman vessels to the extent that you get them with brass molds. So terracotta. Terracotta, very importantly, thinly lined with soot as a release agent. Seems to work. And at the time, there are plenty of terracotta molds for, say, making oil lamps. Ceramics were very often made in mass production by pressing them into molds. And the molds are terracotta being used to form objects of terracotta. So it's reasonable.
Reasonable.
Any last? Could somebody run? Thank you.
Was the same mold used for the deep blue Ennion ewer at the Tel Aviv Museum as our deep amber
Ennion
ewer? And could they have done a folded foot instead of a crack-off foot, because that would have been much stronger?
Well, of course they could have, but we don't have blown, I would call that a blown foot, and a blown foot added from above as the Venetians do. I can only think of a couple of Roman objects that are probably from the first century, more likely the second century, with true blown feet. I think that's a later development. So no, I don't think they would have the capability. The alternative would be to furnace finish the foot and then crack off the top. That wouldn't work because they certainly wouldn't want a cracked off top. And they also had, at the top of the vessel, and they also had to put a handle on it. So they really had to hold it from below. So I think the answer is no. Your first question is really interesting. Could the Eretz Museum example and our museum example come from the same mold? They certainly could. Whether they did or not warrants close scrutiny to investigate that. They're going to be in the same room together in New York, and they're going to be here, and it would be a great thing to pursue. I think that's a neat thing. You always find little idiosyncratic characteristics of every mold, a little flaw, a little error, a little unevenness in a pattern, and you can always look for those in parallel examples. So we'll do that. It's a great idea. Yes.
So would multiple molds be made off of one core, or was it pretty much a mold per core sort of operation?
The person on the planet who knows more about that than anybody is this fellow David Hill. And it's a good question. I think he uses the positive, the original, for multiple times because there's no damage done to it in the process of making the mold around it. I'll ask him that. But I'm pretty sure he uses his carved positives again and again. And he does carve the positives. He doesn't use molds taken of original objects and then turn that into a mold. He always sculpts them freehand. When you do it the other way, this first way, it always makes it smaller, of course, and you lose a lot of detail. Logically, it makes a lot of sense, but in practice, it's a very poor way to do it. Any last, why don't we make one last question? Jane. Hi.
I've read several theories about where Ennion's shop factory was located. And I just wonder, what's the latest theory? What do people think now? Because I think there have been several different places.
Well, Donald Hardin in the early 50s, when he published the theory that Ennion started in Greece and moved to the Italian peninsula. And specifically that the mold-blown things were made on the Italian peninsula. Jenny Price disagreed with that in the 70s. And I think it stands. Jenny's going to be at this conference in New York in a couple of weeks, and it'll be interesting to see what she thinks of it now. But at present, I think the idea is that Ennion was working on the Italian peninsula when these were made. It's a Greek name. The letters are Greek. I think there are, in this field, in terms of the wheres and the whens, way more questions than answers. way more. But that has been up in the air for about 50 years, the question of Ennion's origins. Even, as I mentioned right at the beginning, was he the glassblower? Was he the model maker? Was he the entrepreneur? We don't know. To my knowledge, no. We have the names of other glass workers who carved their names in their positives, but other than the names as they appear on the objects, I don't happen to know of those. But let me be clear, my specialty is about techniques, not the archaeological and the art history aspects of objects, though I'm very interested in those. That's not my area of expertise. Thanks. Well, thank you all very much. You've been very attentive. Appreciate it.